Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Alhamdulillahi Hamd Shakirin, Wassalatu Wassalamu ala Sayyidil Mursaleen, Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala Sayyidina Muhammad, Tibbil Qulubi wa dawa'iha wa nuril absari wa diya'iha wa afiyatil abdani wa shifa'iha. Wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala Sayyidina Muhammad. Today's subject is a subject which confuses many people because of the day and age that we live in, which means that events that occur around the world, and those events occur with haste and a fast-paced world, quick-moving world, people want to interpret the events that are occurring in light of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what we commonly hear is a reference to the Dajjalic age, or some people say Dajjal system. So what is the Dajjal system, and who is Dajjal the individual? Additionally, there are people who are denying Dajjal as an individual, when it is something well known amongst Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah that Dajjal is also an individual, a specific person that exists and will appear in the end of times. Of course, there are many signs for his appearance, which has been covered in previous lectures. But globalization, the monoculture of the world, that what we see is that the world is consumed by a monoculture, a one world culture which envelops the entire globe. This monoculture, ideologically monoculture also, meaning for instance in Britain and the US we have ideologically one ideology that governs the country, but you may have a two tier party system, but ideologically they are the same. So this globalization that we are witnessing, because Muslims have suffered a type of trauma with regard to the New World Order or the globalization that we are currently experiencing post-Khilafah, post-Caliphate, meaning after the demise of the Caliphate, we had the building of nation states, and the trauma that we face is that Muslims have lost a political identity, a political unity, which existed somewhat over 100 years ago, where there was a preservation of Islamic historical sites, Islamic history. Now what we are observing in Jerusalem, occupied Jerusalem, is a destruction of our history at the hands of the Zionist Jews and this non-Jewish supporters. Recently, one of the historical gates was destroyed in Jerusalem, Al-Quds al-Sharif. And likewise, in the Haramain, in the blessed two holy sanctuaries, there is a change occurring, which has been occurring for numerous decades, but now is being fast-paced. The change is occurring with Neom, the building of Neom, a new city in the Arabian Peninsula, in the northern northwest of the Arabian Peninsula, just under Jordan, a $500 billion project. This is changing the very identity of the Muslim world culturally and historically. So this trauma that we are facing, people need an interpretation of what is going on in the light of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. So what is referred to as a Dajjalic system, there are some similarities between the way the world is governed today in the post-Khilafah world. There are some people who reject the concept of Khilafah, saying that the Khilafah only existed for the first 30 years of Islam and the rest of the caliphates were not valid caliphates, from the Banu Umayyah to the Abbasis to the dynasties in between, but nevertheless, they gave allegiance to the Abbasi Caliph up to the Uthmaniyun, the Ottomans. This is incorrect because the system of governance more or less was the same for 1300 years, meaning the source of law was from the Quran and the Sunnah, and a codification of the Sharia law, the interpretation from the Quran and Sunnah. So there was a centralization of Islamic governance to a degree. It varied from time to time in different periods of history, but there was a focal point upon which Muslims had some sort of consensus, which does not exist any longer. Some people attempted to make Saudi Arabia that point of consensus, meaning that the Arabian Peninsula became known as Saudi Arabia post Ottomans, and some people attempted to make Saudi the focal point. Therefore, we have the announcement of Eid going in accordance with Saudi Arabia, or the announcement of Ramadan in accordance with Saudi Arabia. Some people attempted to make this seem as if it were divine revelation, that when Saudi announces Eid or Saudi announces Ramadan, even though they knew that the Saudis have a fixed calendar, which is known as the Umm al-Qura calendar, they have already determined the dates of Eid and months of Ramadan in the next years to come, not based upon the prophetic way of moon sighting, which is also one of the signs of the end of times that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam prophesied. But now Saudi Arabia has been discredited, especially due to its current rulers, and therefore that pivotal role that Saudi Arabia played previously, it no longer holds, especially if they allow Israel the Israelis who are occupying Palestine to use the airspace and other ties that they may have formulated. So the similarity between the fitna, tribulation of Dajjal, and the current world globalization, or you can say the Anglo-Euro power structure that governs the world, which controls the IMF. The IMF is based in the United States of America. The UN is based in the main building is in New York. Likewise, power itself, meaning political power, military power, and economic power is within the United States of America, which culturally is Anglo-Euro at its core. So the Anglo-Euro power structure that governs most of the world, or governs many aspects of our lives, what are the similarities between it and the tribulation of a Dajjal? One of those similarities is what is referred to as deception. Now, the word Dajjal itself is deception. This is why Dajjal, one of the meanings of Dajjal is to cover something. So you cover the truth. The truth is always covered. Dijla, the river Dijla, is referred to river Dijla, Tigris River in Iraq, because the water covers the land. If you have an aerial view, you will see that the water is covering the land. That covering is why the river is referred to as Dijla. So Dajjal itself means to cover the truth. And the Anglo-Euro power structure that we have today, it covers much of the truth, meaning facts or history itself can be reinterpreted. Many facts can be hidden also. So a type of manufacturing of consent is done through, to utilize Noam Chomsky's title of one of his books with regard to the media, a manufacturing of consent is done. So how words are phrased, a double speak is utilized, employed in language, and that is unique to this culture also, meaning the very unique nature of how things are covered. So Dajjal is also a deceiver. He covers things. And the power structure that we see today is also deceiving, that even on social media, they have a concept known as fake news, that even people can spread fake news within a few minutes across the globe. And this is an age of deception. So Dajjal is one aspect. Additionally, the plundering of resources, the plundering of resources is in the world today, what we observe with regard to the plundering of resources is unmatched in human history. What we have today, if we read statistics, for instance, we will have, we will read that the plundering of resources causes the deaths of thousands of people on a daily basis. For instance, I have some statistics here which I wanted to read out. Here, the United Nations World Food Programme, for instance, this is taken from the second recommended book, Confessions of an Economic Hitman by John Perkins. You can check in the end notes what he mentions. The United Nations World Food Programme, as a reference, he references this to the website, and then he states, in addition, the National Association for the Prevention of Starvation estimates that every day 34,000 children under 5 die of hunger or perceivable diseases resulting from hunger. Starvation.net estimates that if we were to add the next two leading ways after starvation, the poorest of the poor, the waterborne diseases and AIDS, we would be approaching a daily body count of 50,000 deaths. So on a daily basis, there are 50,000 preventable deaths, meaning these deaths of young children are caused by human plundering of natural resources. He also states, in 1998, the United Nations Development Programme estimated that it would cost an additional $9 billion above current expenditures to provide clean water and sanitation for everyone on Earth. It would cost an additional $12 billion, they said, to cover reproductive health services for all women worldwide. Another $13 billion would be enough not only to give every person on Earth enough food to eat, but also basic health care. An additional $6 billion could provide basic education for all. Combined, they add up to $40 billion, meaning $40 billion are sufficient to give everyone a decent education, food, sanitation for water, health care for any illnesses. $40 billion is half the cost of the invasion of Iraq. So the invasion of Iraq cost around $80 billion. $40 billion is half of that cost. So the Anglo-Euro power structure that we have that governs majority of the world, they have sufficient resources to remove the problems that they have caused. Now, some people, they mentioned to me that charity aid is done from these countries, like we have Red Nose Day in Britain, for instance. It may collect 12 million, raise 20 million, 30 million. On the same day that those collections are made, those same countries that the collections are made for are paying debts with accumulated interest on debt that they are still paying to those same Western nations that are claiming to give some form of charity to those plundered nations, the abused world. So rather than utilizing the world, the term, the third world, the term better is the abused world, meaning those resources are plundered from those countries. This is why this was the second recommended book in our reading club. So get on to purchasing this book, Confessions of an Economic Hitman, by John Perkins, and read this book. But there are many other books that cover this in detail also. For instance, the current occupation of Palestine, the citizens of occupying Israel claim that the land was empty prior to Jewish immigrants entering in the late 1800s and then increasing in number in the early 1900s, and then after World War II, the numbers increasing exponentially. They claim that the land was empty. It was a vast empty land, especially the western side of occupied Palestine. They say it was empty land. The Jewish migrants just came and they settled down and built homes, and they created the state of Israel post Ottoman Caliphate, claiming that there was no Palestinian state. Now, it would be correct to say there was no Palestinian state at that time, and some Muslims are duped by this propaganda. But it is incorrect to say Muslims never governed the area. The area was governed by Muslims for over 1300 years. Muslims governed Palestine. Therefore, Palestine is a Muslim struggle and not a nationalist struggle. It is the struggle of over 1.6 billion Muslims and not the struggle of just the Palestinian people. If the Palestinian people make it a nationalist struggle, they are isolated. They become isolated like they have been by other Arabs like the UAE, Bahrain, and other countries that have isolated the Palestinians based upon nationalist identity. Therefore, our identity is Islam and Muslim, and our religion is Islam. So they claim that there was no one living on the land, and the Israeli settlers came and just settled and created, formulated what is today known as Israel, and then they expanded. And Benjamin Netanyahu, a Pole, he's Polish, meaning most of the occupation is done by Europeans. The modern plastic state of Israel is a European extension. It's an extension of Europe, like Australia. And they share many common factors with Australia. Australians also did a revisionism of history. How did they revise history? They claimed when they entered Australia, a huge island, if you can call it an island, a huge mass of land, they claimed only 200,000 Aborigines were present on the land. A revisionism of history. When James Cook came and placed the Union flag in Australia, claiming Australia for the white man at that time, they claim now that there were only 200,000 Aborigines in the land, when in reality, the correct estimates are over 600,000. Then a genocide occurred. A genocide occurred that the Aborigine population decreased, and today they account for only 2% of the population of Australia. A genocide, a human genocide. Yet Australians never utilize the term genocide for what occurred with the Aborigines. Likewise with Palestinians today, with the expansion of the illegal occupation, the state of Israel, what is attempted is a genocide of the Palestinian people. So when the state was declared, over 800,000 Palestinians were evacuated from modern day occupied Palestine. 800,000. They left, they went to Jordan and Syria. And this is why the Syrian government in history never gave Palestinian citizenship, never gave them Syrian citizenship. Why? Because they said they are Palestinian, they should wait for the recognition of a Palestinian state and return back to Palestine. This was the policy of the Syrian government, in order that the Palestinians return back to Palestine. Those 800,000 evacuated Palestinians are residing in places like Lebanon, Jordan, and Syria. And then you have the Palestinians within occupied Palestine. Such suppression of a people leads to assimilation of some of them, because people ask that when they go, they say some of these people who are influenced by Prevent and read books by Ed Hussein, that type of ideologue, they will claim that the Palestinian Arabs are living and coinciding in peace with the Israeli occupiers. That may be the case with segment of Palestinian society that just wants to live. If you are occupied for so long and your people are undergoing such a genocide, a removal of your history, there are some people who would just want to live life. and live a normal family life, and therefore they may give up some of their claims. There are those people who attained an Israeli passport, Palestinians who attained an Israeli passport. So this system that we observe, these are some of the similarities between what a Dajjal will do, displacing people. He will go into an area, and when he would go into an area, if the people refuse to acknowledge him as God Almighty, he will not supply them with water and not supply them with food, and those people will suffer. And in other places he will go and he will supply them with water and with sustenance and with food, and they will live in prosperity. And this is why Nu'aym bin Hammad, rahimahullah ta'ala, in his book Al-Fitan, he mentions a narration of one of the companions of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. He states that a group of people will accompany a Dajjal, and they will say, we know he is a Dajjal, we know he is a deceiver, but we accompany him. Why? نَأْكُلُ مِن طَعَامِهِ وَنَرْعَى مِنَ الشَّجَرِ, that we eat from the food and we graze our animals with the trees, meaning we receive benefits. But when the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will descend, it will descend on them also. Like the UAE today, like those minority of people in Pakistan and other countries who are urging the governments to recognize Israel for economic ties. They claim there are benefits in having economic ties with Israel. This is as if Israel, which is what the extension of the Anglo-Euro occupation of various lands like Australia and Canada, native people, natives were the original residents of Canada and America, likewise Australia, as if to say that if you make ties with us and you recognize us, we will benefit you with food and drink and with economic prosperity. But if you refuse to recognize us, you will suffer. Your economy will suffer. Economic hitmen, a type of terrorism that occurs and has occurred in the past with Iraq, when there were sanctions on Iraq, and the Americans caused the death of over 500,000 children in Iraq, meaning through sanctions. Whatever the statistics may state, meaning if someone, Madeleine Albright, when she was asked, is it worth the death of 500,000 children? She said yes, meaning the sanctions. But the sanctions affected whom? The general population. Like the depleted uranium, when it struck populated areas, the people who died were the civilians, not the military of Saddam Hussein. So these are similarities between the Dajjal system and the current Anglo-Euro world that we see, that Muslims, many Muslims, are attempting to make sense of. That when they refer to this as the Dajjalic system, they see the similarities that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam described, that the Dajjal will do these things. They see those similarities, and therefore they describe the system as the Dajjalic, like with the proliferation of riba interest, the harms that the IMF does. If someone researches just the IMF, the International Monetary Fund, those debts, when those debts are not repaid, what are the benefits that the IMF takes from those countries? And very rarely do those countries ever recover from economic slowdown or poverty when they go below the poverty line. So one hadith which relates to the ecosystem, which I will mention, people, when the Australian fires, bushfires occurred, and remember, even the Australian farmers were only successful in Australia because they would take the advice of the Aborigine people. The Aborigine people would advise them correctly how to deal with nature, because they lived in nature. But the bushfires, when they occurred recently and millions of animals sadly died, people lamented the death of those animals. But has Western Anglo-Euro civilization lamented the deaths of hundreds and thousands of Aborigines? Or the 2% of the Aborigines that reside in Australia and to this day in a racist, xenophobic country like Australia do not have civil rights? Meaning, South Africa went through the apartheid, but Australia is similar to, if not worse, than South Africa in many regards. It produces many xenophobes, the like of the man who carried out the terrorist attack in Christchurch in New Zealand. So this fire that occurred is a matter of concern for Muslims. Why? Because the ecosystem and the cycle of animals is important and is mentioned in the Quran and the Hadith. How in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah An-Nahl mentions the bee, the honeybee, and how the honeybee takes pollen and then it goes back to its beehive and then from its stomach comes out honey. This pollination, cross-pollination of a bee is so important that the bee takes the pollen from one plant to another, cross-pollinates plants. If the bee did not exist, so many plants would not be cross-pollinated that in some places there would be a famine because certain fruits will not grow. This is the importance of the ecosystem, that the natural system continues. Maybe this is why the wisdom is that the Palestinian tree is the olive tree. They plant the olive tree, a tree that has roots deep in the ground, a tree that benefits people, even the bark and the wood of the olive tree is beneficial to people, the fruit. Unlike the buckthorn tree, the tree of the Jews, what the Jews do is they uproot the olive tree, Palestinian olive trees, and they plant buckthorn trees, gharqat, the buckthorn tree. So in one hadith, or athar, you could say, mawquf, upon Sayyiduna Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, there is an interesting narration with regard to the ecosystem. And interestingly enough, in Mishkatul Masabih, the famous book of Al-Imam Muhammad bin Abdullah Al-Khatib Al-Tabrizi rahimahullah ta'ala, this hadith is just before the chapter on Ad-Dajjal. So he places the hadith just before the chapter on Ad-Dajjal. What is the narration? And this narration is very interesting. An Jabir ibn Abdullah, from Jabir bin Abdullah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, companion of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he states, Fuqid al-jaradu, the locusts, Fuqid al-jaradu fi sanatin min sini umara, that from the years of the caliphate of Umar radiallahu anhu, the locusts disappeared. Now this locust creature is an interesting creature. In some of the madhahib, you can consume them. In the Maliki school, you can eat locusts. This is why the Malikis would allow beetle, the beetle insect also. They allow many things in the Maliki school, insects. So when people ask regarding M&Ms, that some coloring has beetle coloring, in the Hanafi school, it would be impermissible. But in the Maliki school, it would be permissible. Nevertheless, once in Al-Madinatul Munawwarah, I was coming out of Babu Salam after giving salam to Sayyiduna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. There was locusts everywhere. And a Yemeni man was placing the locusts in a jar. When someone inquired, why are you taking the locusts? He said, I will use them for medicine. Then I told him, you are not permitted to do so because these locusts are from the haram. From Al-Madinah to Munawwara, the entire city is a haram. So you cannot take these locusts. Nevertheless, the locusts disappeared. They never appeared that year. Allati tuwfiya fiha. This was the year in which Sayyiduna Umar radiallahu anhu passed away. He was stabbed by a Persian man. فَاهْتَمَّ بِذَٰلِكَ هَمَّنْ شَدِيدًا. He became worried. Sayyiduna Umar radiallahu anhu became worried. This shows that the caliph has concerns over the ecosystem. Sayyiduna Umar radiallahu anhu famously said that even if a goat dies on the banks of a river, then Umar is responsible. The caliph must have concern regarding the ecosystem, the trees, the plants, the creatures. He became worried. فَبَعَثَ إِلَى الْيَمَنِ رَاكِبًا. He sent a rider out to Yemen to go and check. So the system of sending riders and messengers in that time, he sent out a rider to Yemen, go and check, are these locusts still around in Yemen? وَرَاكِبًا إِلَى الْعِرَاقِ, and one rider to Iraq. وَرَاكِبًا إِلَى الشَّامِ, and one to Syria. Syro-Palestine, the entire Levant, is known as Asham. يَسْأَلُوا عَنِ الْجَرَادِ, inquiring regarding the locusts. Did the locusts appear? Seasonally, animals appear like frogs. In certain times of the season, they appear. In the springtime, in Pakistan, there are frogs. This is a part of the ecosystem. I mean, each creature has its benefits. هَلْ أُرِيَ مِنْهُ شَيْئًا, was anything sighted from them, from the locusts? فَأَتَاهُ الرَّاكِبُ الَّذِي مِنْ قِبَلِ الْيَمَنِ. So Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, he would go out to check, has any of these riders returned? One day a rider returned from Yemen. When he returned, what did he do? He threw بِقَبْضَةٍ, with a qabda, meaning a handful. فَنَثَرَهَا بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ, he threw the locusts in front of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, showing him that there are locusts surviving. فَلَمَّا رَآهَا عُمَرُ كَبَّرَ, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu gave takbir, Allahu Akbar. This was a common practice of his. Even in Palestine, in Jerusalem, there's a mountain called Jabal Mukabbir, the mount of the Mukabbir, the one who says takbir. Why? Because when Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu descended into Jerusalem, he saw Jerusalem and he said, Allahu Akbar, the mountain became known as Jabal Mukabbir. وَقَالَ سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. So Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu states, I heard the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم say, يَقُولُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ خَلَقَ أَلْفَ أُمَّةٍ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created 1,000 ummah. Now note, someone who may object to the hadith, the word ummah is used meaning nations, but it's categorizing animals and creatures. From what I checked last, only 90 to 95% of the world's animals have not been categorized creatures. So 5 to 10% of the world's creatures have been categorized, creatures and plants maybe. Meaning there are so many things that we still do not know. In countries like Ecuador, 15% of the world's bird species are in countries like Ecuador, in one country. So, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ خَلَقَ أَلْفَ أُمَّةٍ. So this categorization is in a specific way that we do not know. Meaning mammals could count as one ummah. Allah knows best. 600 مِنْهَا فِي الْبَحْرِ, 600 in the sea. And how much of the sea have we discovered? A very small amount. وَأَرْبَعُمِئَةٍ فِي الْبَرِّ, 400 on the earth. Meaning 400 categories of creatures, however we categorize them. فَإِنَّ أَوَّلَ هَلَاكٍ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةُ الْجَرَادِ, the first one that shall perish is this, the locust. The first one to perish will be the locust. فَإِذَا هَلَكَ الْجَرَادُ, when the locusts perish, تَتَابَعَتِ الْأُمَمُ, the other creatures will follow consecutively. كَنِظَامِ السِّلْكِ, like a string, meaning when beads full of a string. This hadith is narrated by Al-Bayhaqi fi Shu'ub al-Iman. Now, the hadith is interesting simply because it mentions ecosystem, and the caliphate, one of the tasks of the caliphate was to overlook the ecosystem. This is why they state that the Ottomans, they knew the benefit of crude oil, but they never utilized crude oil abundantly simply because they saw the environmental costs of utilizing crude oil. So the ecosystem is something also affected by a Dajjal and a Dajjalic system. So when people see the similarity between the Anglo-Euro power structure that we have, they refer to it as Dajjalic. Fitnatul Dajjal. Now there's a hadith in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad that states that no tribulation occurs in human history. No tribulation occurs except it is in preparation for a Dajjal. With this hadith in mind, we can say that any type of tribulation that occurs, it supports Fitnatul Dajjal. So there may not be an actual link between a Dajjal, the individual, and certain governors and certain systems of governance, certain ideologies, groups, individuals. There may not be any actual link with them and a Dajjal, but the fitna, the tribulation that is caused by those groups or individuals, will still be referred to as fitna to Dajjal, simply based upon the rule that any tribulation that occurs is in preparation for a Dajjal, meaning al-Masih al-Dajjal, the deformed one al-Dajjal. Any fitna, any tribulation that occurs based upon this hadith. In fact, in one hadith, it states that anyone who was happy with the killing of Uthman radiallahu anhu, if a Dajjal appears, he will become a follower of a Dajjal. And if he is in the grave, he will believe in a Dajjal in the grave, in an authentic hadith. This shows that when Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu was killed, martyred, the killers of Uthman radiallahu anhu, they had no connection with the Dajjal, the individual. Yet, by causing fitna, they had some connection with Dajjal simply because of tribulation. And this is how we would explain modernity and globalization. That even if governments and corporations and people who cause fitna and rulers do not have a connection with Dajjal, are not in communication with Dajjal as far as we can prove, then the fitna, the tribulations people may do, even Muslims, the fitna, the tribulations that Muslims do and carry out has a connection with Dajjal. And therefore, people may refer to the global geopolitical state of the world today as a Dajjalic system because of the similarities between the fitna, tribulation of a Dajjal, and the tribulation that we are observing. The hadith of resistance, that this globalized world will continue with Muslim resistance to fitna, tribulation, will continue until the appearance of a Dajjal, the individual. In one hadith, in this hadith, which in Iqtud Durar, he quotes the hadith, and the hadith is actually an authentic hadith. The Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam, this hadith, the first one, is in the Sahih of Imam Muslim. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "La tazalu ta'ifatun min ummati yuqatiluna 'anil haqqi zahirina ila yawm al-qiyamah." That a group of my nation shall never cease fighting in the way of truth, fighting for the truth, zahirin, apparently, ila yawm al-qiyamah, up to the day of judgment. Another version of the same hadith states, "La tazalu ta'ifatun min ummati yuqatiluna 'ala al-haq." A group shall never cease fighting for the truth. Zahirina 'ala man nawa'ahum, that they will be apparent on those who abandon them. Hatta, or those who oppose them. Hatta yuqatila akhiruhum al-masih ad-dajjal, until the last group will fight al-masih ad-dajjal. So the false Messiah, a group of Muslims shall always fight for the truth in every age until the last group shall fight the false Messiah. In another hadith, the group is specified. This hadith is narrated by Sulaiman bin Ahmad al-Tabarani in al-Mu'jam al-Awsat specifying the group and their location. The hadith states, لا تزال عصابة, a group shall never cease, من أمتي, from my nation, يقاتلون, that they will fight, على أبواب دمشق, on the surrounding areas of Damascus, وما حولها, and whatever is around Damascus, meaning Asham, the Levant. And we know where the likes of Sultan Salahuddin, Nuruddin Zangi, and other rulers were from, alayhim rahmatullah. وَعَلَىٰ أَبْوَابِ بَيْتِ الْمَقْدِسِ, and around the surrounding areas of بَيْتُ الْمَقْدِسِ. وَمَا حَوْلَهَا, and the surrounding areas of بَيْتُ الْمَقْدِسِ. لَا يَضُرُّهُمْ, will not harm them. What? خِذْلَانُ مَنْ خَذَلَهُمْ, the treachery of those who are treacherous to them will not harm them. ظَاهِرِينَ عَلَى الْحَقِّ, they will be apparent on the truth. إِلَىٰ أَن تَقُومَ السَّاعَةُ, until the day of judgment is established. This group of people shall never be harmed by those who betray them. So the people today preserving Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, they will not be harmed by the treachery of UAE. They will not be harmed by the treachery of Bahrain and other countries that have shown treachery to them. If you go there to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa Sharif, you will notice that group, that they preserve the masjid. Individuals of Baytul Maqdis, people of the city of Jerusalem, with their own life and blood, they preserve the masjid. They fight the Israeli occupiers with hands, not with guns, with hands. And they protect Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa Al-Sharif. In another hadith, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam specifies another group, ala abwab al-taliqan, a group of people from an area known as al-taliqan. Now, regarding them, the hadith states, hatta yukhrij Allahu kanzahu min al-taliqan, that until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala extracts his treasure from this area known as At-Taliqan, فَيَجِيءُ بِهِ كَمَا كَتَبَ مِنْ قَبْلِ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring them out the way he has ordained. At-Taliqan is an area which is specified as two cities, that between the area of Marwur-Rawd and Balkh, which is in modern-day Afghanistan. In Afghanistan, in the area of Taliqan, whenever Khurasan is mentioned, Taliqan is a part of that. Khurasan is in eastern Iran and western Afghanistan. So these are the areas that are specified. There is one more hadith also that specifies an area of Turkey also. So these are the groups of people that will continue fighting for the truth. And when Al-Masih al-Dajjal, the individual, appears, they will fight him also. Then we have additional hadith which give us more light and elucidation with regard to our current situation. One of those hadith, which is narrated, recorded in the Mishkat al-Masabih, but the exact hadith, this hadith is found in the Jami' of Al-Imam al-Tirmidhi and the Sunan of Ibn Majah, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ستكون فتنة تستنظف العرب قتلاها في النار اللسان فيها أشد من وقع السيف, which means a tribulation shall occur, تستنظف العرب. This means, remember the word تستنظف, with regard to this, the meaning of this, if you take something in its entirety, that something will occur amongst the Arabs which will afflict all the Arabs. تَسْتَنْظِفُ الْعَرَبَ, the ones who die in that tribulation will go to hell. قَتْلَاهَ فِي النَّارِ, اللِّسَانُ فِيهَا, the tongue in that tribulation is more intense. أَشَدُّ فيها, so al-lisanu fiha ashaddu, is more intense min waqa' saif, than the strike of a sword. In the past, scholars attempted to interpret this hadith with various interpretations. But today, the meaning of the hadith is very clear, that this tribulation is the tribulation that we observe regarding the Arabs from the treachery against the Uthmani Khilafah until today. That those who were treacherous against the Uthmani Khilafah, when they died the death of treachery against the Khilafah. And today, those who commit oppression, when they die, those who commit oppression, they oppress the masses. They die, قَتْلَاهَا فِي النَّارِ, the dead are in hellfire, meaning the dead who commit oppression and those who kill innocent people. قَتْلَاهَا فِي النَّارِ. What we have observed from the various wars amongst Arabs in the past decade, the hadith here states that the tongue, al-lisanu fiha ashaddu min waqi' as-sayf, the tongue is more intense than the strike of the sword. Why? That even social media, people will write a sentence or two, it can cause more death than one strike of a sword with writing something on Facebook or these other means of communication. So this is one aspect of the end of times that we live in. Of course, there are other hadith which relate to fitna to Sham, that there will be a tribulation in Sham, specifically on the authority of Sa'id ibn Musayyib rahimahullah ta'ala in the fitan of Nu'aym bin Hamad, and it states that the fitna of Sham shall last 12 years. In another hadith, for 18 years. And at the end, the Euphrates River shall dry, and then a gold shall appear at the end of the fitna to Sham. And it mentions in that hadith that the fitna to Sham shall start like the play of children. The play of children. What happened in Dar'a was that children, they wrote graffiti. They drew graffiti or wrote statements regarding the regime, and they were taken in by the secret police, the Mukhabarat, and then they were killed, tortured and killed. This inflamed the city of Dar'a, and then which caused the great tribulation of Ash-Sham. Whether that is this particular fitna, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. We will know after 12 years have transpired or 18 years have transpired. It is always best not to make predictions, because the hadith becomes clear once it takes place. The rule is, once the sign occurs, the sign is clear. An example of this, so many people read the hadith which states that a man will leave his house and his shoelace, shoestrap, shall tell him what happened and occurred in his home when he left, or his stick informed him of what occurred when he left. But now, when this sign has occurred in our lifetimes, we know what this means very clearly. But imagine someone attempting to interpret this prior to the inventions, gadgets that we see today. They would make mistakes. So people who make predictions will always fall into mistakes. So I would say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. After this, there is the hadith also which mentions the various tribulations that will occur before the tribulation of Ad-Dajjal, the individual. The hadith of Abdullah bin Umar radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma, he states, kunna qu'udan 'inda an-nabiy sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we were sitting with the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, fa dhakara al-fitana, he mentioned the tribulations, fa akthara fi dhikriha, he mentioned numerous tribulations, حتى ذكر فتنة الأحلاس, until he mentioned the fitna which is known as فتنة الأحلاس. الأحلاس is the cloth that is placed on the sofa upon which the person sits. فقال قائل, someone said, وما فتنة الأحلاس, what is this فتنة الأحلاس? The Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, هي هرب وحرب, it is two things, harb, which is running away, and harbun. But if you say harab, it would mean the wealth of a person. Harab. Then he sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, thumma fitnatu sarra. Then a fitna, a tribulation known as as-sarra. So he said, dakhanuha, it's smoke, min tahti qadami rajulin, is from underneath the 2 feet of a man, min ahli bayti, from my household, the smoke of this tribulation. Yaz'umu annahu minni wa laysa minni, he will claim he's from my household, but he will not be from, meaning he will claim ties with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but he will have no ties. The scholars, some of them said that this was in reference to the king of Jordan, the king of Jordan of old, meaning the Amir of Makkah, who betrayed the Uthmani Caliphate. وَلَيْسَ مِنِّي. That would make sense if you take Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa into account. إِنَّمَا أَوْلِيَاءِ الْمُتَّقُونَ. My awliya are those who are al-muttaqoon, meaning they have taqwa. They keep Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in mind. ثُمَّ يَصْطَلِحُ النَّاسُ. Then people will make, after this tribulation, people will make istilah, meaning treaties and peace. عَلَى رَجُلٍ. Upon a man, meaning they will make alliances with a man, meaning unknown people. كَوَارِكٍ عَلَى ضِلْعٍ. Like the hip bone on a rib bone. A weak alliance. Weak alliances shall be formed. ثُمَّ فِتْنَةُ الدُّهَيْمَ. Then a fitna which is known as fitnatu duhayma shall occur. A dark fitna. A duhayma. This dark fitna, لَا تَدَعُ أَحَدًا مِنْ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ. It will not leave anyone from this nation. So this tribulation is the one to note. This tribulation will not leave anyone. إِلَّا لَطَمَتْهُ لَطْمَةً. Except it will slap them. Meaning it will affect everyone. فَإِذَا قِيلَ انْقَضَتْ تَمَادَتْ. As soon as they say it has finished, تَمَادَتْ, it will continue. What is this fitna? What is this tribulation? The effect of this tribulation is such, يُصْبِحُ الرَّجُلُ فِيهَا مُؤْمِنًا. A man will wake up in the morning as a believer, mu'min. وَيُمْسِي كَافِرًا. And in the evening he will be a kafir. This is the fitna, tribulation. حَتَّى يَصِيرَ النَّاسُ إِلَى فُسْطَاطَيْنِ. Until people shall be 2 camps. There shall be only 2 camps. فُسْطَاطُ إِمَانٍ. The camp of iman, faith. لَا نِفَاقَ فِيهِ. With no hypocrisy. وَفُسْطَاطُ نِفَاقٍ لَا إِمَانَ فِيهِ. And a camp of hypocrisy which will have no iman. فَإِذَا كَانَ ذَلِكَ. When that occurs, فَانْتَظِرُ الدَّجَّالَ. Then wait for Dajjal, meaning the individual at Dajjal. Min yawmihi aw min ghadi, meaning from that day or the day after, meaning the time of Dajjal will be very close. That time, fitnatu ad-duhayma, many contemporary scholars have recognized it as our time. And we can observe this for ourselves, that in the morning a person is a believer, he believes in those things which are known in religion by necessity, but by the evening he holds different beliefs. Then he may read something else or watch something on social media, and in the morning believe in something else, and in the evening believe in something else. From those tribulations is this tribulation of rejecting the meanings, clear decisive meanings of the verses of Al-Quran Al-Kareem, or the clear decisive hadith narrations of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, like denying that there is an individual at Dajjal, a person who shall be a mass deceiver. This is also a dalala, a misguidance, a point of misguidance. Before moving on to that point of misguidance, I wanted to mention another interesting hadith with regard to our age, and that hadith is, this hadith is also in Mishkat al-Masabih. The original of the hadith is in the Sunan of Al-Imam Abu Dawud, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يُوشِكُ الْمُسْلِمُونَ and yuhasaru ila al-Madinati. It shall happen that the Muslims shall be encompassed, the city of Al-Madinatul Munawwarah shall be encompassed, yuhasaru, hatta yakuna ab'adu masalihihim silah, that the furthest guarded area shall be an area known as silah, meaning the city of Al-Madinatul Munawwarah should be protected from far, meaning the entire Arabian Peninsula is Muslim. But in the end of times, what shall occur? That the Muslims in Al-Madinatul Munawwarah shall be surrounded, that the furthest guarded area, guarded border, shall be an area called Silah. What is Silah? Silah, it states in the Hadith, meaning the commentators say, the sub-narrators, Silah qareebun min Khaybar. That Silah is an area that is close to Khaybar. Now, what is Khaybar? Khaybar is the Jewish fortresses. Those Jewish fortresses are a UNESCO heritage site, protected. And it would not surprise me today if Saudi Arabia announced that they are protecting all the Jewish history in the Arabian Peninsula. It would not surprise me if the Niam that they are building extends all the way to Khaybar. They have announced recently within the Medina province, meaning the area known as the Medina province, not the city itself, they are building some complexes. You can find this information, that they are building something for tourists. But Khaybar is a Jewish fortress that was conquered by Muslims. It would not surprise me, due to these alliances with Greater Israel now, these alliances, that the announcement of Niam becoming Greater Israel in one way, as well as Khaybar being a preserved site, and of course Israeli citizens being permitted to enter the Arabian Peninsula to visit those Jewish historical sites, which they will reclaim for themselves. Then you have a Saudi lawyer claiming that Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa is not in Jerusalem. Recently, a Saudi lawyer claimed that Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa is in Arabia, and the Muslims have falsely ascribed Jerusalem to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In fact, the Saudis even published a Quran translation in Hebrew where they translate Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa as the Temple Mount. As if to say the Temple Mount is the correct translation, it's the false translation. The translation was removed later, meaning the entire translation in Hebrew was removed. But the claim of this lawyer that Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa does not exist in Jerusalem, this is something that they would want to promote, a revisionist style, like the person who denies a Dajjal is an individual, or the Mahdi does not exist, or Isa alayhi salam will not descend. This is revisionism of Islam, in order that Islam is no longer a political threat. It does not question the New World Order. Islam, like men, are no longer men. They are made into women. The aspects of Islam that are a threat to the New World Order will be removed. So one of those is the identity of Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. This affiliation with Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa must be undermined by what some refer to as the New World Order, or the Anglo-Euro occupation of Palestine. So Niam City is the new project of Saudi Arabia. This hadith that I mentioned, generally, when scholars recite this hadith, they would have understood it to mean the occupation of the Arabian Peninsula by Ad-Dajjal in past. But today when we read the hadith, it becomes clear that the Muslims will be limited to the Haramain al-Sharifain, to Makkah al-Mukarramah and al-Madinah al-Munawwarah. And the furthest they could go out to is Silah area, which is near Khaybar, but not to Khaybar itself. It would make sense if the Muslims in the near future now are only permitted to go to Al-Madinah to Munawwarah without traveling out into those areas, because those will be areas will become Jewish heritage sites. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, but in the near future we will see these signs occurring in front of our very own eyes, that the expansion of Israel now, the greater Israel that is being made, alongside with Egypt, that Sisi now has announced a new capital for Egypt. Who are the contractors? Who is paying for the project? For Saudi Arabia to extend Neom, Israel is only above 40 miles away from Neom, near Jordan. It would be necessary for Saudi Arabia to have some type of contact with Israel, some type of deals and alliances with the occupying state of Israel. So these are things to take into consideration. Before moving on, some questions with regard to the descent of Isa alayhi salam. A question that was asked is that when Isa alayhi salam will descend, and the hadith states that he will break yaksiru salib, he will break the cross, wa yaqtul al-khinzir, and he will kill the swine. Someone made a mockery of this and said, how can this be a sign that a Muslim does not go near the cross or near a swine, and Isa alayhi salam will do this, a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So the question is, if this is literal, then it does not make sense. And if you say it is a metaphor, then why is it not permitted for us to say the descent and rising of Isa alayhi salam is also a metaphor? The response to this question, and of course the questioner, I hope you understand that this methodology is the unguided, undefined epistemology. I mean, these questions are from an undefined epistemology. The response is very simple. If I say to you Queen Elizabeth made roads in the UK, does it mean that Queen Elizabeth went herself, like we see the builders on the roads with those machines, and she was digging the roads and placing the coal into the roads and straightening the roads? The answer is no. You will understand from that Queen Elizabeth ordered her government subsequently ordered the councils and then whoever, the motorway services, and they paid for all the expenses. But we would say Queen Elizabeth has done this, or the Prime Minister has done this. So when it is said Isa alayhi salam will destroy the cross and kill the swine, it is literal. In what sense? That the Christians will become Muslims and no longer have the need of a cross. So the cross will be destroyed. And because the Christians will become Muslim by choice, the domestic swine will be done away with. No one will have domesticated swines. So the domestic swines will be done away with. And that is the meaning of yaksiru saliba wa yaqtul al-khinzira. Literal. The meaning is literal. So you do not win on that point. That if we can say that's not literal, then you can say the descent and the ascension is not literal. Secondly, it is important to mention, denying the ascension of Isa alayhi salam, and this must be listened to with care, with attention. Denying the ascension of Isa alayhi salam is kufr, disbelief. Denying the descent of Isa alayhi salam is bid'ah, innovation. The kufr in the ascension is because the Quran is explicit regarding him being raised. And I've covered this in previous lectures, which the points have not been refuted. The points still remain. That when the Quran states, بَرَّفَعَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهِ, this is very explicit linguistically. Now this is very important when I say unguided, unspecific epistemology. That when we interpret the Quran and the Sunnah, it is important that the Quran and the Sunnah is interpreted with the rules of grammar, Arabic grammar, and the rules of rhetoric, ilmul balagha. You cannot say, oh, it can mean this or it can mean this. There's an imbecile who says whatever hadith is related and will say, this doesn't make sense to me, therefore it can mean this. Without utilizing grammar, without utilizing balagha. For instance, The hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that the anbiya are alive in their graves, and also that the bodies are not consumed by the soil. A person states, this means that the message shall live on, because this is what he understands from his mind. But he does not utilize Arabic grammar. He does not utilize Arabic rhetoric. He's just giving what he understands. What does this lead to? Firstly, his interpretation would be incorrect. Secondly, there would not be one Islam. There would be 1.7 billion Islams. Because Zayd will say he understands this. Amr will say he understands this. Bakr will say he understands this. You will have 1.7 billion Islams. This is why Ijma' is so important, consensus. But aside from consensus, utilizing Arabic grammar and Arabic rhetoric. If this imbecile attempted to do this with grammar and rhetoric, he would be unable to do so. He would be unable to demonstrate that meaning from Arabic grammar and Arabic rhetoric, even classical poetry, that the literal meaning is not meant. So, additionally, there was a second question on this, that if someone observes Isa alayhi salam descending, the very meaning of us being on this earth is a test. So when we see him descend, we will believe, because only a very contemptible person will not believe. A person who has a hard heart will not believe. So what type of test is this that we see Isa alayhi salam descend? The very meaning of being tested on earth is removed. The response to this absurd question also is that in the past, there were hard-hearted people like Fir'aun who observed various signs at the hands of Musa alayhi salam and his army, and they did not believe. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us khariqul ada, suspension of the norm, a miracle from time to time, there will still be people who will have hard hearts. Like some of the Quraysh, when they saw the moon being split, they said, our eyes, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, according to them, did magic on their eyes. They denied the sign. So the very meaning of a test will still exist even when Isa alayhi salam descends. This brings me to a note on miracles. Firstly, what is the very meaning of miracle? The very meaning of miracle is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates the miracle. So when someone denies a miracle, they are in fact denying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's divine will and divine power. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to create this. Secondly, someone stated again that Sai Baba of India, he performed ostensibly miracles and he was a misguided individual. Therefore, miracles do not prove anything. Sometimes I become shocked at these people that they claim to have studied deen to their audience, that have they ever bothered to read the books of Kalam where they mention that firstly a miracle is based upon the claim. If the person has false claims and performs a miracle, something which seems like a miracle, a miraculous feat, that is referred to as istidraj, not mu'jiza or karama. Istidraj, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may even create at the hands of a deviant person a miracle. You can have pious people, on their hands Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates a miracle which is known as karama. At the hands of the prophets alayhimus salam, it is known as mu'jiza. But if the person is a deviant, it is known as istidraj, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can create an ostensible miracle at the hands of a deviant, even though with Sai Baba his so-called miracle was only one or two things. He would produce an egg from his throat, a gold egg from his throat, and that was a trick with the handkerchief. And the second was dangling chains and silver watches from nowhere. He was actually taking it out of the sleeve. So he was discredited. But let's say for argument's sake that Sai Baba or someone else did a miracle. How do we judge the authenticity of such a person, it's with the mind. So the Quran and the Sunnah and the teachings of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah do not say the mind is not involved. You look at the claim. Was the claim of the person correct? Then it is counted as a karama, or with a prophet as a mu'jiza. But if the person is wrong, a wrongdoer, then you look at the claim from the mind. Is the claim correct? Like he claims a human being is God Almighty. This is incorrect logically. Additionally, this person and his followers cannot make the distinction between the empirically observable and the rationally impossible. Empirically observable is those things that we are accustomed to. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can sometimes suspend the physical norms. This is possible. Rational impossibilities involve those judgments solely from the mind. If I told you 2 and 2 is 5, it's a rational impossibility because I can deduce that from my mind without observing. Even a blind person can tell you 2 and 2 is not 5. Why? Because they never observed this, but they can tell you this from their mind. But if someone tells you that fire can go cold, this falls into rationally possible, but in the physical realm, we do not observe it. We do not feel it. So if it happens, very rarely, it is referred to as a miracle. And it happens very rarely, because if it occurred every day, it would no longer be a miracle. So miracles occur rarely also. This is, of course, an entire discussion that I've elucidated in the past, and I've elucidated in one of my forthcoming books also. So Dajjal's power, some people ask, will he have technology by which he does these things? I will answer this in two ways. Number one, the hadith that state, for instance, a Dajjal will ride a donkey, or these type of hadith, when they occur in the future, the meaning will become apparent. Meaning, like we have the hadith that states that a man will leave the home and his strap of his shoe will tell him what his family did after he left. Today we know what that means with modern communications. The hadith states his stick will tell him what his family did while he was away. Today we know what that means with gadgets like cameras that sound and video record. So when a Dajjal appears and he rides this donkey, even though the word donkey is utilized, we will know what it means when it occurs. Any guesswork prior to that can be mistaken. But a person with a flawed methodology will reject the hadith. They will reject the hadith because they will say, this makes no sense to me, therefore I reject the hadith. But the hadith will make sense when the sign occurs. Secondly, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates within a Dajjal to perform feats, miracles ostensibly, this is a possibility, but we know he is false. Why? Because his claim is false. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can create that within him, but his claim is false. So any miracle is judged in accordance with the claim. Before finishing, I want to mention that this flawed methodology, that denying a Dajjal the individual, is based upon a flawed epistemology. None of these people can ever define how they reach these conclusions. They can never give you a sound methodology that is equally applicable to all hadith. Like Al-Imam Muhammad bin Idris al-Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala, he wrote a risala, a legal theory, a book which sets down the guidelines of how to interpret the Quran and the Sunnah. Today we have people, they will reject Al-Mahdi, claiming all the hadith on Al-Mahdi are forged. Even though scholars have compiled, for instance, the author of Iqdu Durar, who is Yusuf bin Yahya Al-Maqdisi Al-Sulami Al-Shafi'i Rahimallah, who passed away in 658, he compiles well over 480 hadith on the Mahdi. Let's say not all of them explicitly refer to the Mahdi, let's reduce this to 200 hadith. The person would have to demonstrate how 200 hadith were forged in order to reject the Mahdi. There are other scholars who also wrote on al-Mahdi, like Sheikh Abdullah Siddiq al-Ghumari rahimullah, and others, and they compiled numerous hadith. Likewise, the hadith on the descent of Isa alayhi salam has been narrated by over 27 companions. Over 27 companions in over 70 hadith. Explicit in the wording, the descent. Now these people reject the explicit wording of the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, what there is agreement, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised Isa alayhi salam. There is agreement on that one point. Rejection of that is disbelief, kufr. In response to this, they say, بَرْ رَفَعَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهِ. Does this mean Allah raised him to himself? Allah is free from location. So does this mean Allah raised him to himself? The absurdity of this claim is such that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بَرْ رَفَعَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهِ, we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says, إِلَيْهِ يَسْعَدُ الْكَلِمُ الطَّيِّبُ, to him ascend the good word. It doesn't mean Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises the word to himself, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from physical location. It means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises the word itself. On the Day of Judgment, the word will physically go up. And today it goes up in Alum al-Mithal, the world of similitude. Likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised Isa alayhi salam to the second heaven. Linguistically, if you take the other meaning, it would mean, the meaning changes. The meaning would be, بَرْ رَفَعَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهِ, rather Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised Isa alayhi salam to his station, to the station of God. So which meaning do you take? Does it mean Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised Isa alayhi salam? But if you say it means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised him to his station, it would mean Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised Isa alayhi salam to the station of God Almighty, which is shirk and kufr. Additionally, the word bal, linguistically, if you check, like Mughni al-Labib and other works, the word bal, the particle bal, negates what comes before and gives the real meaning for what comes after. There are many other points to be mentioned. So they reject explicit verses in the Quran. Now, one of these individuals cannot fathom miracles. It's too hard for him to understand. He cannot make a distinction. He's too stupid to know the distinction between Ahkamul Aada and to this day he cannot explain it. Ahkamul Aada and Ahkamul Aql. The empirical judgments and the rational judgments. For the birth of Isa alayhi salam through virgin birth, he rejects that. Why? Because he cannot fathom this. But the simple response is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can create that within Maryam alayhi salam. So the entire Quran is reinterpreted as rejecting all the miracles of all the prophets alayhi salam. So what message is left in the Quran? Why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention such things? The entire Quran becomes meaningless with such absurd interpretations. So this is a new methodology of some people affected by old methodology. In fact, the methodology is old. What they are doing is copying and pasting from Mustafa Maraghi and others who took from earlier sources like some of the Mu'tazila. So they are regurgitating and recycling old arguments. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to safeguard us from al-fitan, tribulations, especially the tribulations of today, where the iman, the belief of a person is in danger. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us death on the correct creed of Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa atubu ilayh.
Someone asked a question, and this way he'll give them time if they want to ask about Imam Mahdi, the job. Someone said that, you know, in regards to Imam Mahdi, when you mentioned the point, they said that we don't believe in Imam.
reject al-Imam al-Mahdi. Ibn Khaldun rahimahullah was a historian, not a scholar of hadith. Secondly, I would like a reference to where Al-Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala denied the existence of Al-Imam Al-Mahdi. I do not believe this is true. So if the questioner can place a reference for that before making that claim, please. So inshallah, we'll finish here. Jazallahu anna Sayyidina Muhammadan sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ma huwa ahluh. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wassalamun ala al-mursaleen. والحمد لله رب العالمين